Okay, so let's get started. Welcome everybody to our special session, I almost said edition of the Oberseminar. And let me welcome our guest speaker, Walter Negus-Dargy. We met about a year and a half ago when you came to see me and you talked about the book you've written. So basically, what you do for pleasure is what we do for work. Because originally you don't work in the field of literature or philosophy, but if you have a very brief bio, you are Privatdozent at the Faculty of Computer Science. So if anybody ever again has problems with his or her computer, you know who to ask, okay? So you work here as Privatdozent at the Faculty of Computer Science. You hold a PhD in Computer Engineering from TU Dresden and an MSc in Electrical Engineering from TU Kaiserslautern. Are from the beautiful Pfalz or Palatinate. I come from that region, so is it hard to survive here?
No, it's okay.
It's okay. Okay. So in your spare time, you enjoy reading. You do write scientifically, and you've also, I think, published one novel. The second is a draft at the moment.
Yes.
So you see, if you have spare time, what you can do. It's great to have you here. We are very curious. We're very interested to see what your approach is on these authors, philosophers, Albert Einstein, Sigmund Freud, Dostoevsky, and Tolstoy. What your take on that, and the topic of your talk is the reason for life. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Professor Horla, for inviting me to give this talk. I have brought a copy of two copies of my book. A free copy of the book is already available online, both from our website at the university and from ResearchGate. So feel free to download and read if you like. So feel free also to see. So I have structured my talk as follows. First, I will give a brief introduction about myself as well as the book I have written. And then the book has mainly three parts. The first one is God as the reason for life or the source of life. The second part is the purpose of human life. And the third one is the biblical account of the reason for life evaluated from the perspective of the four subjects I identified. But we don't have time to deal with all these three parts. So today I'm going to focus only on the second part of the book, which is the reason for human life. When I'm invited to talk about this book, now this is my third time, mostly my audience want to know want to have an answer for one important question, which is, why do you write the book in the first place? So I will begin by giving a brief answer to this one before I delve into the subject of the book. It has both personal and professional reason. Let me just quote Freud to answer this question. Freud says, or writes in one of his books, a very good work of art at once reveals the three principal dimensions of aesthetic experience. That is the psychology of the protagonist, the psychology of the author or the writer, and the psychology of the writer himself or herself. So when we find ourselves deeply moved by Hamlet and his ambivalence to murder his uncle, we are not only witnessing Hamlet's psychological dilemma, but also the dilemma of Shakespeare as Hamlet's creator, and also our own internal dilemma. So I'm not going to argue the accuracy of this statement, but with this statement I'm going to say partly I wrote this book because to answer my personal questions. I've been preoccupied with these three topics for nearly 20 years. So one of the main reasons why I wrote the book is to satisfy my own curiosity. The second reason I wrote is almost every day I meet people coming from all walks of life, from different culture, different educational background. I have spent more than half of my life in university environment, and often I engage young people about these three questions. What's the reason of life? What are the most noble aspirations towards which we should head? So I thought maybe by committing my ideas to paper, I can answer as far as I can this question. To give you a brief overview about myself, I came originally from Ethiopia. I was born into a Christian Orthodox family. But when I was still young, my country became a communist country, and almost overnight, a Christian congregation, going to church, reading the Bible, were forbidden. So all spiritual books have been collected and removed from our presence. So I grew up with this indefinite psychological state. We have this Christian heritage, but at the same time we don't practice, and new ideologies have been introduced into our school, our familial and social environment with which we need to grapple with. At the age of 16, I was completely disillusioned. I was neither atheist nor a believer, so the question implanted in me that who am I? What am I existing for? And then when I was at 18 years old, I joined college and I met my first German professor from East Europe at that time. And of course I engaged this person with these questions, and he was one of my aspirations. He introduced to Feuerbach, to Hegel, and to some of the 18th and 19th century philosophers. So I started digging deep into philosophical work to answer my own question. But when I was 24 years old, I was fed up with philosophical works one more time. And my brother, my eldest brother, he was newly converted to Christianity, and he offered me the Bible. So that was the first time I came face to face with the Bible. Being very curious and also a literary person who loves literature, I wanted to know what the Bible talks about life, about God, and the purpose of human life on earth. Of course, the first few books of the Bible were great stumbling blocks, but my curiosity drove me deep into the Bible, and by the time I came to the Gospels, I realized that the Bible was rather a very serious book. A book which gives answer, some of which I couldn't accept, but it wasn't also a book I could throw away or put aside outright. So these are some of my personal, some of the personal backgrounds which motivated me to study the answer this quartet gives about the purpose of human life, God at the source of human life, and also to see how they regarded the Bible and some of the answer it gives. Okay, after this brief introduction, I'm going to focus on the second part of my book, The Purpose of Human Life. What do they say? What do Albert Einstein, Sigmund Freud, Tolstoy, and Dostoevsky say about the purpose of human life, and how much has it affected their professional life, and how, in return, their professional life has affected their philosophy. Almost all of you, I'm pretty sure, know that Albert Einstein and Freud lived in Europa at the time Jews were persecuted. And both of these people were of Jewish background. So to a certain degree, their philosophy, both, not only their philosophy, but also their professional life, has been affected by the social circumstances. But more importantly, Freud's own personal life, he's been preoccupied with the sexual instinct for reason I may mention later on. And Einstein has also been working with deterministic model to describe the universe and physical phenomenon. So to a certain extent, their own personal life has also influenced them to define their philosophy of life. So if we begin with Freud believed that, or he maintains that the question that what is the purpose of human life has been answered time and again, and has got no answer. So he suggested instead to study human behavior and try to answer the question from the behavior itself. And Freud said that human beings, most importantly, want to be happy in life and to remain so. And there are only two basic instincts which the fulfillment or the gratification of which make them happy. All other psychological endeavors, all other psychosexual or cognitive endeavors can be explained, he maintains, according to these two instincts. If these two instincts are not gratified, human beings consider life as bad and meaningless, and if they are satisfied, human beings consider life as fulfilling and good. So he identified only two instincts, and these are the instincts of sex and the instinct of aggression. And these two basic instincts are opposing by nature. The instinct of sex, its tendency is to unite the organism into an ever larger unity, whereas the instinct of aggression is to dissolve this organism into its primary substance. And what we consider a fulfill or a normal life is the attainment of equilibrium between these two instincts. So according to Freud, not only the meaning of human life can be interpreted in terms of the gratification of this need, but all other psychological illnesses can be interpreted as the disturbance of this balance, the balance between the gratification of these two instincts. And he also says, if we examine some of the most important literary achievements in human history, they all deal with these two instincts. He identified three literary works which he considered significant. The first one is Sophocles' Oedipus the King. The second one is Shakespeare's Hamlet. And the third one is Dostoevsky's The Brothers Karamazov. And Freud argued that all these three books at once deal with parricide and incest. And he says that it's not by accident that all of them deal with these two subjects. Because even from the very beginning, human beings attain self-consciousness. The first challenge they have been confronted with is the frustration of the sexual need. Because he said the first patriarchal father, he possesses all the female to himself and drove out the children and all male from his surrounding. Then these brothers and sons came together, murdered this patriarchal father, and distributed the females among themselves. But after they have distributed the females among themselves, they realize that they have to introduce certain laws in order for the social organism to exist as a peaceful and unified organism. So they introduced certain laws, and the tendency of this law is not to gratify the instinct of aggression and the instinct of sex, but to frustrate them. As a result, from this, from then onwards, from the time human beings attain self-consciousness, there is this demand to satisfy sex and the instinct of aggression, but at the same time to curb these needs in order to maintain the social organism. So he says, Sophocles' Oedipus the King, Hamlet, Shakespeare's Hamlet, and Dostoevsky, the brothers Karamazov, reveal the eternal human struggle to come to terms with these problems. Other than that, Freud maintains that human beings have a human existence has no noble purpose on earth other than satisfying the basic instinctual needs. Einstein, on the other hand, being a physicist, he rejected all notions of purpose. Einstein maintains that human beings as such have no purpose on earth, inasmuch as a corporal body, a physical body, has no specific purpose to exist. And inasmuch as a corporal body obeys certain physical laws, all human tendencies and actions, both within and without, obey to physical laws. So he rejected the idea that human beings have a purpose for which they should be existing. He also rejected the idea of freedom. We obey natural laws. So the strive to satisfy our need is a result of obeying those physical laws. So he rejects this human freedom. But Einstein also understands that because human beings are conscious, self-conscious, they cannot exist without believing that they have purpose for their life. So he identified four types of freedom, or the illusion of freedom is important for human happiness, without which life becomes intolerable. So he said human beings should attain freedom from self, freedom from time, freedom from the social entity, and freedom of expression. Later on, when I discuss about Tolstoy, I will come to some of this concept in more detail. But for Einstein, this illusion of freedom in human beings makes life simply tolerable, but it doesn't give the message a purpose. For Tolstoy, both Tolstoy and Dostoevsky, of course, accept the idea that human existence has a specific purpose. And both of them, being devoted Christians, associate their existence, or the purpose of their existence, to the discovery of God's will in their life. For Tolstoy, the purpose of human existence is to pursue perfection. Human beings cannot abide living a life which is empty. And Tolstoy recognized two essential vices which get in the way towards discovering purpose in human existence, and that is self-deception and falsehood. In all his books, in all his mature books, beginning from War and Peace to Anna Karenina and all his later books, Tolstoy grappled with these two social vices and how they become causes to great human suffering and unhappiness. For example, in War and Peace, we find four different aristocratic families. All of them, it is at a time when Russian culture was flourishing, but also imported culture from France and Europe has been invading the upper class, or Russian class, the aristocratic and the upper middle class families. And he sees how falsehood and self-deception has hampered the Russian aristocracy to see the abject poverty with which the majority of the Russian population has been subject to and suffering from. So he says, unless we are confronted with our inherent vices, it is impossible to discover true happiness in life. And without true happiness, it's also impossible to discover the purpose of human life. In most of his novels, Tolstoy often introduces his main characters to great and sudden change, under the burden of which some of them discover what is permanent and essential in life and reject what is false and temporary. Some of them, of course, will never be able to discover this. So, for example, we can find in War and Peace, Prince Andrew, Prince Pierre Bezukhov, Princess Maria, we also find Natasha, all of them being subject to great suffering. And as a result of suffering, finally discover their capacity to love and to do good. There are also some characters in Tolstoy's book, for example, the Oblonsky family in Anna Karenina, the Alexei Karenin himself, and the Vronsky, Count Vronsky, some of you are familiar with, even if they are subject to suffering, are not able to discover true happiness because they are unable to liberate themselves from these two essential vices, which are falsehood and self-deception. When we come to Dostoevsky, among this the quartet, Dostoevsky is a passionate defender of Christianity and probably one of the most potent writer who, with remarkable vividness, defends the Christian values. Dostoevsky, in almost all of his books, introduces rebellious characters which question the existence of order, the existence of absolute good and absolute evil, and who rebel against God. So, for example, in The Devil, one of Dostoevsky's books, we see Nikolai Stavrochi. We find Peter Verkhovensky, who questioned the existence of good and evil, the existence of beauty, the existence of true love and sympathy, and because they all think that these are human prejudices. And in The Brothers Karamazov, we find even Karamazov questioning the existence of good and evil, the existence of eternity, the existence of afterlife. Dostoevsky uses these characters to demonstrate that the biblical account of fall, sin and redemption make sense only if we accept the idea of God, and that is responsible for life on earth. So for Dostoevsky, the purpose of human life is to identify God's will through self-abnegation. Dostoevsky, similar to Tolstoy, believes that self-deception or self-consciousness is the greatest evil that has happened to human beings, because acute self-consciousness always alienates human beings and forces them to be individuals rather than a part of the big picture. Dostoevsky also believes in human freedom, in the existence of absolute human freedom, which can be attained or regained by foregoing self-needs. So for Dostoevsky, human beings can attain true happiness on earth by letting go, by identifying themselves as a part of the universe, and instead of striving to satisfy their own needs, if they strive to satisfy God's will, he says, they can attain true freedom, and through this true freedom, their existence on earth can get meaning. In summary, this of the quartet, Einstein accepted the idea that God has created this universe, brought human beings into existence, but he does not believe that God interferes in creation. For Einstein, God is impersonal, and all things on in the universe obey natural laws. Tolstoy and Dostoevsky, on the other hand, they accept the idea of personal God and believe that human existence or human life gets meaning in coming into contact with this personal God. Freud rejected the idea of God and attributed that human existence is a great misfortune and a great accident, but it gets meaning as long as human beings try to gratify the two basic instincts, but they have to achieve the two basic instincts in the way or in such a way that they can attain a certain equilibrium. If you upset this equilibrium, this would lead to neurosis, according to Freud, and this also lead to human grief and unhappiness. So I think for my talk for today, I have given you some overview about the book. If you have questions, we can discuss about this, but if you have time, please read the book and feel free to contact me to discuss some of the ideas presented in seminar.
Thank you very much for your presentation. And let's start with a discussion.
Okay.
Any questions? Who wants to go first?
Yes.
Just a comprehension question. You said some things about how you came to write the book.
Yes.
How did you come to select these four bearded men here?
Okay. I wanted to address actually in my talk, but I didn't want to make the talk longer, so I removed that from my talk. Okay. How I came into contact with the works of Tolstoy and Dostoevsky is apparent, because as I say, my country was at that time a communist country, and most of the books which were accessible to me were books written by either Russian mm-hmm. or German writers. I think when I was quite young, I came to read Poor People by Dostoevsky. I liked it immediately, and I started to read almost all the books he has written. Likewise, I read Tolstoy. Then I studied engineering. So when I was in college, I came to know Albert Einstein, And I fell in love with his models of theory of relativity, Brownian motion, his explanation of the universe and the quantum theory. So I started reading also the philosophical works. I was also, when I was in college, I was also expected, as a part of the curriculum, I was expected to visit some of the psychological courses, and that's how I came to know Freud. So this all led into knowing these people better and also discovering that they have been occupied with the same questions I have been occupied all my life. So I read and finally selected these people to my question. I hope I have answered your question.
In a way. I mean, I can infer that they are the one. I can gather how you get in touch with them as it were originally, but evidently they are the four, frames of references that left most lasting impression upon you, I take it.
There were other philosophers, evidently. For example, we can mention Leibniz or Spinoza. But these people addresses not only the philosophical aspect, but also the literary aspect and the scientific aspect of my needs. Okay, so when it comes to Einstein, I being an engineer and he being a physicist and knowing his physical works and knowing that he was also dealing with a philosophical question. So it makes sense to select him as a candidate. When it comes to Dostoevsky, it's not just the philosophical aspect, but the psychological aspect, the literary aspect, he satisfied in me. So these were the motivation for identifying this woman.
There's a wonderful, what was it? Tour d'horizon, tour de force, I'm not quite sure.
Which one?
Your presentation, thanks a lot for that.
Okay, thank you.
I haven't quite decided that for what it was for, what it was for me.
Okay.
There's one thing that you mentioned in your introduction, which I, maybe that opens up a new field, and if you don't want to enter that, fine by me. You mentioned the Bible.
Yes.
And what I find rather interesting in terms of the questions you've been asking for, or you were so fascinated with Freud and Einstein and Tolstoy and Dostoevsky, poses the same questions very differently if you're dealing with the Bible. I'm not talking about revelation, and I'm not talking about really about the Bible is as the name says, there is no coherence in it. Although there is of course some coherence in it, but it's Tabitha is the books, collection of books. Would you say so something like, I would like to relate that to how you framed Freud and Einstein and Tolstoy and Dostoevsky. Could you say something similar within the, well, it's maybe too much for the Bible, so your approach to the Bible.
Okay, the first thing, as a side remark, the quartet were amazingly versed in the Bible. If you read Dostoevsky's book, almost all Dostoevsky's characters knew the Bible by heart. They extensively referred to the Bible. Tolstoy, in fact, in the end, he tries to harmonize the four Gospels. He wrote his own Bible, so to say, right? Freud, too, he's been, for nearly 20 years, he's been preoccupied with the Pentateuch, with the first five books of the Bible. And in his book, Moses and Monotheism, he tried to rewrite the Pentateuch, so to say. So they've been extensively versed in the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
And I myself have been immersed into the Bible for nearly, as I say, 20 years. So in this aspect also, I relate with these people. As to me, you're asking my personal opinion about the Bible, right? Is that what?
Well, along the same lines as you've been dealing with the other four.
Yes.
So I'm not asking for your belief or something.
No,
like
yeah,
that.
I understand.
Mm.
I understand.
Yes, but
My impression about the Bible is, you say that the Bible is diverse, and indeed it is diverse. But I also see amazing consistency in the Bible from the very beginning to the end. This is something impressed me at the literary work. It's been written by different people. It's been edited, very many times. But for example, from the very beginning, when you go to the Genesis, the idea that the first human being has fallen, and are the consequence of this fall, there's been a divorce between God and his creation, and that God tried to reestablish his unity with his creation, beginning from Genesis, has consistently been addressed throughout the Bible until the last book, which is the Revelation. So I see this amazing persistency of theme, despite the diversity of the writers, the culture, the educational background, the history, the time span of the Bible. So this is my first impression about it. If I have answered, so it's amazing that persistently people, some of the books of the Bible have been written in the wilderness, some of them in ancient Israel, some of them in Babylon, some of them in Rome or in Corinth or in Galatia or in Philippine or in Thessaloniki. So despite the diversity of the writers, as well as the time and the places, this persistent message that something is wrong in creation and God wants to reestablish it, it amazes me. Anything else?
Yeah, I wonder if I come back to your talk. You did present four perspectives on reasons for life.
Yes.
But you did not offer any conclusion.
I did.
How would you, then I missed it. Could you please, so what's your conclusion? How do they interact? Where do you get something which goes beyond those four perspectives?
Yeah.
Would be one question. And the second would be, would it make sense? I have the impression from what you present, it's pretty homogeneous. Would it have been interesting to include Nietzsche, Sartre, Joyce, maybe?
Definitely.
To open that up, to get more diversity into?
I don't know if I can, if I agree with you when you say it is a homogeneous. The philosophy is completely diverse. As I said, when it comes to God as a source of life, for example, Freud rejects it.
Mm-hmm.
Albert Einstein believes that, okay, there is God, but he's impersonal. So in this case, he agrees with Spinoza. He agreed with Leibniz, right? In his notion of an impersonal God, who has nothing to do with his creation. When we come to Tolstoy, for example, he accepted the idea that God is personal, but he believes that God has given human beings the capacity to do good, and he doesn't reveal himself in any other way. So he rejects it. The idea that the Bible is a revealed truth. So only Dostoevsky accepted the biblical account of creation. So they are quite diverse. But the reason I limited myself in four is otherwise the book would become an encyclopedia. And I cannot really treat the issues in more detail if there were six or seven additional people involved in the book. So that's why I limited myself.
You don't think it would have brought different perspectives to
probably
you,
not.
Kind of you and Sartre?
Probably not.
Okay.
Probably. If I put Kant, it would give a different perspective. But then Kant is an ocean, so you cannot fit it into one book, right? So it would be a superficial treatment if I pretend to address Kant in this book. So I deliberately limited myself out of Kant, because partly I didn't feel qualified, and B, I didn't feel that it would do him justice to limit him to this review. When it comes to the conclusion, that's when it comes, regardless of their view about the purpose of human life, all of them agree that the most sublime goal one can accept as the purpose of human life can be summarized by the two biblical verses, almost all of them took one by one. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the Bible, but I will say this much. When Jesus was on earth, he's been asked time and again, what was the biggest commandment? In other words, these three people, for example, Dostoevsky, Tolstoy, and Einstein, they have asked the same question. What is the most sublime goal towards which human beings should aspire? And amazingly, all of them agree in this biblical account which Jesus gave. That is, to love your neighbor as yourself. Man is not an island, entire of himself. We can't, our life gets meaning and enrichment in as much as we identify with other people, in all aspects of our life. So they agree that this commandment to love your neighbor as yourself is indeed towards which we can aspire. Freud rejected this one because he claims that the ego cannot satisfy this need. Because if we love our our neighbor, or if we tend to love, or are willing to love our neighbor, regardless of the whether or not our neighbor deserves our love, he claimed that it would make love valueless. Freud insisted that my neighbor should earn my love. So love for Freud is an exclusive property that can be given selectively to a few who are worthy of it. So other than Freud, all the three agree that this is a noble and sublime goal, whereas Freud say this is a commandment which cannot be attained on earth.
Yes. That reminds me of a question that was asked to the then young Prince Charles in 1981, I think it was, when he introduced to the public his fiancée, Princess Diana, and said, "Do you love her?" And his answer was to the press was, "Whatever love is." My point here is, well, I use that anecdote is, what you just do is a kind of shift, isn't it?
Mm.
The shift is, I would sort of subscribe to what you say, maybe for, although I don't know them by far not as good as well as you do, talk about the two Russians, about the Dostoevsky and Tolstoy, nor do I know the philosophic words of Einstein, is the question of, you define them or you describe them as ex negativo in a way. Same with Freud, and you brought something like the unifying thing in a positive term that is love.
It is, yeah.
But love is a very the English word love is a very deceptive thing. Sort of if you take for instance, if you wrote down as keywords in Freud, it's all in the Bible for that matter. It's eros and agape.
The Greek use four different loves, by the way. Right? Yeah, the Greeks are more explicit in their understanding of love. You're right.
What?
But when they refer, at least the three of them, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the idea of love in the Greek. They used to storge, philia, agape, and eros to distinguish between the different love. The storge is affection that comes from nearness. So you may fall in love with your laptop, because it's been with you for many days, with all your old shoe or your old couch, because you love it, it's been there, it's comfy. But when they refer to love, they don't mean this type of love. It's the agape you just mentioned. A decision, not a feeling, to accept and do good to your neighbor. So this was the kind of umbrella term which unified the three of them. So when they say love your neighbor as yourself, they meant decide to do good for him, whether or not he deserves or she deserves it. independent.
You use the agape term for, not as Freud does the eros.
Yeah, for Freud it's the eros, true. So, because of his, you know, his understanding love as eros, for him the basic instinct being, you know, satisfying the need of eros, he says this type of love is not something you can't distribute to everybody. So the other person, the object of love, should deserve it to be eligible to receive this love.
Any further questions? What about the last backbenchers?
These are the two PhD students, my PhD students.
Okay, so, yeah. Okay, two questions each, please.
They are engineers, you know. So.
Oh,
no,
they're
used to ask questions.
Okay. No problem. Then thanks a lot for your presentation.
Thank you again for inviting me for this talk.
We really enjoyed that.
Okay.
And we see each other again, I think, on January 9th, right? With news about Jack the Ripper. Hmm. Those who I don't see before that, Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Thank you, and the same to you.
Try not to be murdered or something like that.